Day 12 of our 12 days of Christmas. Oh my gosh. Thank you so much for being here. I'm Christine. It's Christine with Astrography. I feel like you know that by now. And today is the last day in this Christmas mini series. And I have saved arguably the best for last for this time of year. I want to talk today about how to photograph Orion. Yes. So a lot of photographers throughout the year are like, Milky Way, Milky Way, Milky Way. Yes, Milky Way is amazing. And you can still photograph the Milky Way at this time of year too. You know that, right? So it's just, we don't get the core of the Milky Way, but you've got the beautiful winter arm, which is lovely. But this time of year, we have Orion. And yes, it's cold. I'm looking at being out in minus 15 degrees Celsius tonight. Not looking forward to that part. But Orion? Orion is stunning. There are gases and nebula around Orion that are just beautiful. And you can create some absolutely stunning compositions. So today, we're going to get into the nitty-gritty of how to photograph Orion. Okay, number one, where is Orion? Now, this is going to change depending on when you are watching this. So I am recording this in mid-December in 2020. Right now, for me, Orion is rising in the east and it is setting in the west, about. So I will use two things to go in and actually see where is Orion rising and setting. So I will use Stellarium on my computer, and on my phone, I will use Planet Pro. And if you guys want to go back to day 8, that's where we went in and we actually looked at visualizing a couple compositions using Planet Pro. And of course, anyone who took my free training, Your First Milky Way Photo, over the past year, you will be familiar with Stellarium because I go in, and in this free training, I actually teach you how to use Stellarium to find the Milky Way, and just use Stellarium to find Orion. If you have never used Stellarium before, you guys are going to want to get yourselves on my newsletter list because I will be launching that free training again in March. And so it's something that's really, really worthwhile to go through. So I will use Stellarium and Planet Pro to actually see where does Orion rise and where does it set? Because I need to know where it's rising and setting so that I can pre-visualize my images. I can start with the end in mind and I know where I'm going to take the images. So then I can start to figure out all of the rest of it. The next, when? What time am I going to go out and photograph Orion? Now, this really depends on the type of image that you want to create. So if you want to create an image of Orion that has Orion and a foreground, you either need to create the image while Orion is rising or while Orion is setting. And so of course, if you're going to take an image of Orion while it's rising, it needs to be dark out. So for me, I can do that now. So I can do it last month too in November. So in December and January, I can photograph Orion rising just after full dark. So after it becomes full dark, I can go out and Orion is rising up. In December, I have a little bit of time after full dark. In January, I don't have that much time after full dark. It's basically right away. And that's for me. I'm at about 44.5 degrees north latitude. That will be different depending on the latitude and where you're at. When does it get dark? When does Orion rise? All of that. Once it gets into February, Orion is up high in the sky by the time it's full dark. So I can no longer shoot Orion rising and get the foreground in at the same time. So now, once I get into February, I have to shoot Orion setting. And of course it's setting in a completely different place of where it's rising, so different compositions come into play. So for February, March, and April, I can photograph Orion setting. After April, there's really not any more opportunity for me at my latitude to photograph Orion. So when you're going to shoot it really depends on what the time of year is. And I will look at photographing it when it's rising in November, December, January. And I could do it when it's setting as well, like here in December and in January. I could do it when it's setting, but then it's just a lot later at night and I want to be in bed because I'm tired. So if I can get it rising, it's better. And then as it gets into the start of the new year, so February, March, and April, it's going to be when it's setting. And so for instance, right now, February, it sets at like 1 a.m. and then by April it's setting at like 10 p.m. So that when is going to depend. And that will also depend on where you live. So that's why using Planet Pro or using Stellarium is really, really useful because you can see exactly when does Orion rise and when does it set. But general guideline, November, December, January, you can get rising, February, March, April, you can get setting. Okay, so we know where to look and we know when to look. Next up, we need to talk about our gear. Okay, Orion will fill your frame comfortably if you're shooting at 50 millimeters on a full frame. That's about 35 millimeters if you're on an APS-C. If you want to just have Orion, that's 70 millimeters on a full frame. And that's like what, 45, 46 or something like that on an APS-C. So like a 50 millimeter. So that will get you literally just Orion. There's not gonna be any foreground in that image. Anything higher than that and you're gonna cut off one of the stars in Orion. You're not gonna get all of Orion into your frame. So I will generally be shooting Orion with me on full frame on a 50 millimeter or 35 millimeter. Those are the two lenses kind of choice for me to shoot Orion. I will sometimes shoot them wide angle, specifically if I can get either the Geminids or the quads as a meteor shower. I will try and get Orion in my frame and then shoot the meteor shower and have a really wide angle because I can get Orion and lots of meteors as well, which is fun. But otherwise, I like to have Orion bigger in my frame, and so that's shooting at 35 millimeters on full frame or 50 millimeters on full frame. Those are my two lenses of choice. Okay, so once you have the lens that you're going to use, then we can get into our settings. And with our settings, two things we need to think about. The first, are you shooting on a tracker? Yes or no? Because if the answer is yes, your shutter speed can be anything. It can be generally like up to 4 minutes. It's kind of the max that I've been able to get with an unguided tracked setup. On a good night, it's not super cold and it's not windy, I can do about 4 minutes, but generally I'm around 2. So your shutter speed doesn't really matter. If you're not shooting on a tracker, your shutter speed is now defined by your focal length. So let's talk tracker first. So my preferred method to shoot Orion is to shoot with my camera on a tracker. When we're shooting at longer focal lengths, untracked, it's a lot shorter shutter speed. So by putting my camera onto a tracking device, I'm able to get much longer exposures. I am generally shooting about 2 minutes long. I find for most of my images of Orion, I'm at 120 seconds for my shutter speed. My aperture, it depends, but generally I'm shooting at f2.8 and ISO 800. Sometimes I'm shooting at f2 and ISO 400. It just kind of depends on the lens that I'm using and the aperture that doesn't give me aberrations. So my 35 millimeter, I get aberrations, so I like to shoot that one at f2.8, but my 50 millimeter is not too bad, so I can shoot that one at f2. So depending on which one I'm shooting with, I will change my ISO accordingly. So that's kind of a good starting point, 120 seconds, f2.8, ISO 800. This depends on your skies. This is with nice dark skies. So this is in like at least a Bortol 2 or a Bortol 3 that's kind of looking out towards a Bortol 2. So I'm shooting on the ocean a lot. So I'm shooting away from any light pollution, which really helps. If you're in an area that has a lot more light pollution, you're going to find those settings might be too bright because you have all of that light pollution build up. Okay, so it's a starting point, but you have to tweak that for the different places where you're at. That's shooting on a tracker. Okay, shooting untracked. Well, now we have to do our equivalent exposures. And this is something, I do this, you guys have heard me talking about this a little bit, but I do this in my free training, my Your First Milky Way free training. We actually go in and do equivalent exposures. And people are always like, oh great, we're doing math, fun. Not what I signed up for, but then they stick around because it's really useful. So if we're at 120 at f2.8, at ISO 800. Okay, if we take that, so we go from 120 seconds, that's 2 minutes, down to 30 seconds, because that's, let's say, if we're shooting not tracked, 30 seconds is gonna be the longest that we can go. So that's 2 stops. So I have to get those 2 stops back with my ISO. So that takes me from ISO 800 up to ISO 3200. So if I'm shooting wide angle, so APS-C, we're about 10 millimeters. On a full frame, you're about 14 millimeters. If you're shooting super wide angle, you can shoot at 30 seconds at f2.8 at ISO 3200. Now that's general. 30 seconds might be a little bit too long. You might need to be 25 seconds. You might need to shift things around a little bit, but that's kind of a good starting point. As we go up to a next lens, so let's say you're a 20 millimeter on APS-C or 35 millimeter on full frame, now we're gonna be at 15 seconds. And I've actually found in practice with my camera, it's about 13 seconds. There's a lot more that goes into it. So I'm basing these numbers off of the 500 rule. I teach that in that Your First Milky Way training that I'm talking about, but there are other factors that come into play. And I go crazy in depth in this. I know I'm glossing over it here, but we've got a lot to go over in this video. I don't wanna keep you here forever. I go crazy in depth in that in my Milky Way Masterclass. because it's the same things that come into play for photographing the Orion, for photographing the Milky Way. So there are other things, but the 500 rule is kind of a good starting point here. So 15 seconds for a 35 millimeter on full frame or 20 millimeter on APS-C. If we're at f2.8, now we have to be at ISO 6400. Okay, so our ISO is starting to get up there because our shutter speed is getting a lot faster. Now, if you have a fixed focal length lens that has a wider aperture, you might be able to shoot at f2 and then you can shoot at ISO 3200. There's a little bit of room that you can work with there. Then we get to 8 seconds. So from 15 seconds, one stop less with our shutter speed is 8 seconds. Okay, 8 seconds is going to be if you're shooting at 3 millimeters on your APS-C, so that might be, it's probably more like a 35 millimeter lens, or 50 millimeters on a full frame. And if you remember, 50 millimeters is generally the longest focal length that I'll go with. So 50 millimeters full frame is 8 seconds at f2.8 at ISO 12,800. Now, some cameras, you don't have that. Some cameras, ISO 12,800 looks terrible. So at this point, hopefully you're shooting with a 50 millimeter lens or a 30 millimeter lens that's a fixed focal length and it has a bigger aperture. So instead of doing 8 seconds at f2.8 at ISO 12,800, you could do 8 seconds at f2 at ISO 6400, okay? Next from that, if you're shooting with a 50 millimeter on APS-C or an 85 millimeter, on full frame, and I say 85 because that's generally you don't have 70 millimeter fixed focal length lens. You have 85 fixed focal length and a 50 fixed focal length. If you're shooting on that, then it's a 4 second exposure. Now at this point, you need an aperture of f1.4 in order to get ISO 6400. So this point, as you get up to that long of a focal length, I probably wouldn't do it without a tracker, to be honest. I would cap it out at 50 millimeters on full frame and 30 millimeters, 35 millimeters on APS-C without tracking, because you're going to get Orion, but you're not going to get the color because you don't have the time. So you don't have the light being able to build up over that time. So that's kind of my recommendation. You can always try and use longer focal lengths, but you're not going to get as bright of an image, and you're not going to get the colors in the image because your ISO doesn't pick up those colors. It's really having the time and having the aperture that opens up larger that gets you the colors. So that's my kind of overall chart for your shutter speeds. It really depends on where you're shooting, how dark is it? I mean, I can't hammer this home enough. Like, go somewhere dark. Like, get somewhere as dark as you can. I know it's cold and scary outside and there's probably a bear that's waiting to eat you. In the woods, it's just like stalking and waiting because it knows you're coming tonight. That's not it, but that's how I feel every time I go out. But the darker the place that you get to, the better your images are going to turn out. So light pollution really is our enemy here. So the numbers that I just kind of went over in terms of our settings are really for skies that are pretty dark. So you want to try and get to that. Now that being said, you have everything you need now. So we know where to look. We know when approximately, and we know the gear to use and the settings to use. So now you just got to go out and do it. So I'm hoping for you that you get clear skies. So our next time of this recording, the next new moon cycle in January, my fingers are crossed that you will have beautiful clear skies and you can get out and freeze your butt off. For those of us who are Canadian, anyone who like lives near the equator and you're watching this, just don't tell me about how warm it is for you when you're out shooting, because I'll be jealous. I hope that you get clear skies and you can get out and you can start to shoot Orion. Let me know what you think of this. If you have any questions, any clarifications that you need. I know today was pretty technical, but it's pretty exciting to get out and photograph Orion, and it's so worthwhile too. So don't just stay at home in your nice warm bed. Get your butt out there, put on some long johns, and let's do it.